Okay, let's start today's morning session. Rob Myers is going to tell us about scanning new horizons, entanglement, and holography.
Okay, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here in Bangalore again, and it's an honor to speak at the Strings Conference. So I was asked to give an overview talk about these ideas. Both of these words are actually commonplace in the language, or at least in my household. But if I go home and I ask my daughters what entanglement and holography are, they'll tell me a story that goes something like this. Now, as string theorists, we all have a much more refined or an alternate definition when we're thinking about holography. And these days, we also have other ideas in mind when we think about entanglement, but it's not that long ago when the string theorists would have been talking about entanglement in these terms here. So I did want to start with a little bit of a review just to make sure that we're all on the same page. So when we're talking about entanglement, we really mean quantum entanglement. And so the issue here is that if I'm talking about a system with many different parts in a quantum theory, then there's a single wave function that describes that entire system. And so because all of the different pieces are described by the same global wave function, there can be implicit correlations between them, no matter how far apart or how removed they are from each other. And so the famous example, of course, is the EPR paradox, where we have these two photons heading off in opposite directions, and no matter how far apart they travel, the measurements that Bob makes over here will be correlated with the measurements that Alice makes over here. So EPR actually put this forward as a contradiction or a problem with quantum theory. Now we understand that entanglement is actually a key feature that makes the quantum world different than the classical world. And so, for example, in quantum information theory, entanglement becomes a resource which they're trying to use to do ultra-fast communications or ultra-fast computations or ultra-secure communications. Entanglement's also arisen in condensed matter theory, especially in the past decade or perhaps decade and a half, where it becomes a diagnostic to identify exotic phases and exotic phenomena. If I'm given a system like this with two photons, and I write down the wave function, it's relatively simple to identify whether or not that particular system or this particular state is entangled. However, if I start thinking about systems with many, many, many different pieces, that task becomes more and more complicated. And so what we would like is some kind of general diagnostic that lets us identify when a state is entangled or when it's not. And so the hero of the day, at least in this talk, is going to be a quantity known as entanglement entropy. It's a very general diagnostic, and basically what we're doing is we're measuring correlations between two different parts of our favorite quantum system using entropy. The place where I'll be applying it is in quantum field theory, and so the context there, or the application there, goes as follows. I want to divide my system into two pieces. So I start with a Cauchy slice, or an initial value slice. I think of the field configurations on that slice as being characteristic of the state space. I divide it into two pieces by introducing, or I can divide it into two pieces by introducing some arbitrary boundary, or I'll use the words entangling surface, so that we have an inside and an outside. We then integrate out the degrees of freedom in this outside region. That leaves us with a density matrix, which describes the physics of these degrees of freedom in the interior. Given that density matrix, we just apply the standard von Neumann formula, take trace rho log rho, throw in a minus sign, and in this particular context, that's what we call the entanglement entropy. Now, conceptually, that's a very simple set of ideas that I've described here. However, in practice, if I actually want to apply this procedure in some field theory, it's rather a difficult calculation. And if I assign this as a homework in my graduate field theory course, I know that a priori, the answer right away is going to be infinity. Unfortunately, this particular quantity that we've identified here is UV divergent because it's dominated by short distance correlations in the field theory near the boundary or near the entangling surface. So to make sense of the calculation, we have to regulate. And I'll do that today by introducing a short distance regulator, which I call delta. Once that's done, then the results of this calculation are parameterized in terms of ratios of delta under, or the ratio of some macroscopic scale that characterizes the geometry here, divided by delta to various powers, where the powers are controlled or depend on the dimension of the space-time. Now, if I do the calculation not just for one particular configuration of the entangling surface here, but I do the calculation for many different configurations, what I'll find is that, in fact, rather than having, or there's a more elegant interpretation of this series expansion, what we can see that it becomes is an expansion like this, where all of those numerators have a geometric interpretation in terms of the geometry of the entangling surface. So the first term here is the celebrated area law term. This r to the d minus 2 becomes the area of this codimension 2 surface. The r to the d minus 4 is also an integral over that surface, but there'll be some collection of curvatures, and so that knocks this power down by 2. Now, we can carry on. There'll be more complicated integrals in the numerator, but one feature of this rather elegant construction is that, unfortunately, these coefficients are going to depend on the details of the regulator. And so a simple way to see that is if I just trade my regulator for twice the cutoff scale, what all of these coefficients are going to change by powers of 2. However, if we persist, or if your grad students persist in calculating the series to high enough order, you will eventually find terms that contain some universal information or regulator-independent information. And so an example here is this logarithmic term, and the coefficient here is some number that characterizes not just the geometry, but the intrinsic features of the underlying quantum field theory that we're studying. Now, that's my review of entanglement and entanglement entropy. And that will be central then to the remaining discussion in the context of holography. But I just wanted to say that, in fact, the information theorists or the information literature contains many, many other diagnostics of entanglement. So, for example, we have the Rainey entropy. So given our density matrix that we've constructed, we might consider taking powers of it rather than taking a logarithm. And this is another measurement of the entanglement between the regions A and B. It comes with this particular coefficient here, so that in the limit alpha goes to 1, one recovers from the Rainey entropies the entanglement entropy with the standard von Neumann formula here. In more sophisticated setups where I might want to compare states, I might be able to apply the relative entropy where I'm comparing two different density matrices, or if I have a density matrix that describes more than one part, I can take what's called a partial transpose and evaluate this quantity that's known as entanglement negativity. Similarly, if I have different regions, I can evaluate the mutual information, which is this particular combination of entanglements. Again, this is only a partial list. But it may be worth keeping in mind that these are choices, other choices, which, at least in quantum information, there's use to applying all of these different formulas in studying different systems. Another comment is that implicitly in the entanglement entropy story, I'm dividing my system into two pieces, and so I'm studying what's called bipartite entanglement, or I'm studying correlations between two different subsystems. But one can do, for example, as it was implicit here, I can do more refined partitions of my subsystem or my system into pieces, and then there will be different characteristics of the entanglement between all of those different subsystems. In any event, those are some review comments. Then I wanted to move on to holography. And so one of the things I wanted to remind people here, or at least a younger generation, is that holography originally came from the discussions of black holes. And so this goes back nearly 40 years now, but Bekenstein and Hawking made the remarkable discovery that black hole horizons carry an entropy. And so they wrote down this formula here, where the area of the horizon characterizes the entropy of our black hole. This formula attracted a great deal of attention because it's a watering hole for many different areas of physics. So we have the geometry here. We've got the speed of light, which speaks to relativity. We've got Boltzmann's constant, which speaks to thermodynamics. We've got the H-bar from quantum theory. And of course, this is a gravitational system, and so we've got Newton's constant telling us about gravity. In particular here, we see quantum and gravity next to each other, and so it was often seen that this should be a window into the properties of a quantum theory of gravity. One of the things that this formula, where I've introduced all of the fundamental constants is, it's a reminder that when we put together those fundamental constants with G Newton in gravity, that quantum gravity provides us with a fundamental scale. So in four dimensions, in my favorite set of units, I define the Planck scale or the Planck length in this particular way. And so what we're doing here in this formula is measuring the area in units of the Planck scale. This hasn't used up all of the fundamental constants. There's this annoying Boltzmann's constant sitting there. But that's a reminder that the people who invented entropy were actually interested in work per unit temperature. They weren't thinking about black holes. But one of the things they learned was that for thermodynamic systems, typically there's a statistical mechanical reinterpretation. And so in that context, we can think that this side is telling us about microstates of the black hole as a system in quantum gravity. And in that context, we typically set Boltzmann's constant just to 1. And so this has the remarkable feature then that information about these microstates is being encoded in the geometry of the space-time, namely the area of the horizon. Another striking thing, though, about that geometry is that it means that the entropy is not an extensive quantity. This isn't a volume. The entropy isn't growing as the volume, rather it's growing as an area. And that was a rather different kind of entropy in the context when this was discovered in the early 1970s. In trying to understand the origin of this entropy, it's actually Raphael Sorkin who coined or ran into the idea of entanglement entropy. And he suggested that the origin of this quantity here is precisely that this should be the entanglement entropy between degrees of freedom on the outside of the black hole and the degrees of freedom on the inside. So our horizon then would naturally play the role of an entangling surface. This is actually a pathfinding insight in that he put these words or put this idea together when people didn't put the words entanglement and entropy in the same sentence. And so he had to devise a new set of calculations, but today we recognize those calculations as more or less the field theory calculations that I described at the beginning of the talk. And so his note was, or what he observed, was this area law term that started or gave the dominant contribution to the entanglement entropy. And he just suggested, well, if this cutoff scale was of the order of the Planck scale, then